Hallelujah and blessings in Jesus, friends. Welcome back to Hayakadosh Ministries, where holiness is a way of life. Jesus is truly King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and the Holy Bible, praise God, is our only standard and authority for truth. And together, God's people say with hearts of joy, Hallelujah. And I trust that you can say that with hearts of joy this morning, friends. I have been under the Word of God all morning, and my heart is bursting with the joy of the Lord. And I trust that yours is as well. Well, today is January the 13th in the year of our Lord, 2017. I did it again. Boy, old habits are hard to break. You see, I did 365 one-a-days last year, and after every single one of those, I said 2017. And so it's so hard to get used to 2018. So please forgive me. Today is January the 13th in the year of our Lord, 2018. And this is One a Day for the Soul. Now, before we begin our time together this morning, friends, I want to say that each and every day I reiterate, and I do it purposely. I tell you how much I love you and appreciate you. And I know that in hearing that day after day after day, it becomes a cliche. It becomes just something you expect to hear as a part of the video, as in a opening or a closing to the video. But I truly want you to know how much I appreciate you, because there are thousands of teachers, Bible teachers across the face of the earth that are teaching the Word of God. And you have chosen, for some mysterious reason, to plant yourself for 15, 20 minutes each and every day and allow me to present the Word of God to you and what God is teaching me in my journey. And so for that, I am very grateful. It is the highlight of my day. It is the joy of my walk. And I truly do care about and love each and every one of you. And I lift you up and mention you to the Father each day. And I pray that you are growing in the Word of God, in the knowledge of the Word of God. And as you're putting it inside of you, it is manifesting itself in the richness that is intended and working itself out so that you are becoming a more faithful follower of our Lord, our King, our Master Jesus, each and every moment of your lives. Well, with that being said, today we are picking up in our journey through the story of the Bible. And this is a somewhat humorous passage. If you're on one side, I guess. If you're on the other side, it's not so funny. But we're going to pick up in Genesis chapter 34. And in my Bible, the chapter is headed The Defiling of Dinah. Now, what is taking place here is Dinah is the daughter of Leah. Now, remember, Leah was the sister of Rachel. She was Jacob's first wife, but not the one that he truly loved. And so it begins by telling us that she went out to see the daughters of the land. It appears that she went out to make a few friends. They're new to this land. They don't know anyone. No one knows them. And so she's going to go out and see if she can make some acquaintances with the other girls that live in that area. But Shechem, who was the son of Hamor the Hivite, and he was the prince of the country, when he saw her, he thought she was so beautiful that he took her and lay with her and defiled her. Now we know that Dinah, being raised in the customs of God, this was something that she would have considered a violation. So most likely, she didn't agree to what was taking place, which would make this a rape. But Shechem loved her and spake very kindly to her. Even though he had raped her, even though he had exercised his will over her will, even though he had used his strength to overcome her, he spake kindly unto her. And so there is a hint here that he was respectful unto her. And so maybe that was just the way of the land that he lived in. Because remember, this was a pagan land. They didn't adhere to the things of God. But Jacob and his household did. Well, Shechem in verse 4 goes unto his father and he says, I want to marry this girl. I love her. And so I want you to act on my behalf. Go to her father and whatever you have to do, get her for me to be my wife. Now, Jacob heard that Dinah had been defiled, that Dinah had been raped, and his sons at the time were in the field. Well, in the meantime, Hamor, the prince of the country, Shechem's father, goes unto Jacob and bids him request to take Dinah to be Shechem's wife. Well, as the sons of Jacob were coming out of the field, they heard what had happened, and they were very angry about the situation. Not only because he had raped their sister, but he had defiled the God of Israel, the God of the family of Jacob, the God of their forefathers, Isaac and Abraham. And so in verse 13, it says, the sons of Jacob used deception. I wonder where they got that from. Remember, Jacob was a deceiver. The apple doesn't fall far from the tree. Jacob learned it from his father, Isaac, who had also used deception in his life. Isaac learned it from his father, Abraham, who had also used deception. So this is just a continual, non-ending cycle that it seems is just falling from one generation to the next. So they use deception, and they tell the men of the city, we cannot give you Dinah, our sister, to be your wife because you are uncircumcised. And this is not acceptable among our people. So what you must do is you must all become circumcised. And if you become circumcised, everything we have is yours and everything you have is ours. We will enter into a mutual peace agreement. But remember, they're being deceptive here. Well, it says in verse 18, these words pleased Hamor, who was the prince of the area, and Shechem, Hamor's son. Now, Shechem simply wants to be the husband. He wants to take Dinah as his wife. And so without even thinking about the consequences, he is so persistent in acting upon his impulses that he doesn't consider anything other than taking her to be his wife. So he quickly agrees as well. But they have to go to their people and they have to explain to all the men of their city that they must become circumcised, which obviously none of them would be very excited about, although their king, Hamor, is announcing this as something that must be done. And so he entices them in verse 21 by saying, these people are peaceable with us. Let them dwell in our land. Let them trade here. For it's large enough for both them and us. And notice what he uses to entice them with. He says their daughters will be made available to us and our daughters will be made available to them. And so he uses women as a prize to entice the men of the city. But the only way in verse 22 they will consent to do this is if every male among us be circumcised as they are circumcised. But if we do this, their cattle, their substance, every beast of theirs will be ours. Now, it seems from this statement that Hamor is also using deception, that once the circumcision is done, he will rule over the people of Jacob. It seems that he has this in his mind. And so in verse 24, Hamor, Shechem, and all the people of the city, every single male was circumcised. And it came to pass on the third day when they were sore. Obviously, they're sore. They're in great pain and misery as they each have had a surgical procedure done unto them. And they don't have the devices that we have today, the surgical instruments that we have today that would make things less painful, maybe more clean. And they certainly didn't have medication to ease these pains. Well, it came to pass, as they were lying sore in the city, two of the sons of Jacob, Simeon and Levi, Dinah's brothers, took each man his sword, came upon the city boldly, and killed everyone in the city. Because the men had been circumcised just a few days prior, and they were in such pain, they couldn't even fight and protect themselves, or their women, or their children. And so they were all killed. And Hamor was killed, the prince of the place. Shechem was killed, the one who had raped their sister. And they took Dinah out of Shechem's house, and they left. They came back, they spoiled the city. They took all the sheep of the city, all the oxen, all the asses, everything that was in the city, and everything that was in the field. They took all their wealth. They took all their little ones, their children. They took their wives for captives, and they spoiled even all that was in the house. And Jacob said to Simeon and Levi, you have troubled me to make me stink among the inhabitants of the land. In other words, other people in this land are going to hear about what you have done, and this is going to cause disharmony between me and them. As we're moving into this new land, we want to cause as few problems as possible. We want to come in quietly and be accepted by the people of the land. But now the people of the land are going to feel threatened by us. They're going to think that we're going to come in and overtake them. And so you've brought conflict into our family. Now, we must remember, Jacob knows the promise of God. He knows that God is going to bless his people. And so even in these stages of Jacob's journey, Jacob's life, we know and we can see that there's still a lack of trust. There's still a lack of absolute belief in the sovereignty of God. That God is in absolute control, he's going to work his plan, and there's nothing that man can do to intervene or stop it. But Jacob does not fully believe that. And so he tells his children, specifically the two that caused all of this chaos, he said, I being few in number, they will gather themselves together against me, they will kill me and all that are with my household. And so again, we can see the lack of trust, the lack of belief in the sovereignty of God from Jacob. But the two brothers simply said, should he deal with our sister as with a harlot? In other words, they got exactly what they deserved. And so when the people of the area hear about what took place, they're going to know that we were only defending our sister. Now, there's a couple of things that we could take from this story. Obviously, one of them being the idea of deception. We've talked about that much in the past, so I don't want to really spend any time on that this morning. What I want to focus on is this idea of taking revenge into our own hands. And that's what we see the brothers of Dinah do. They take it upon themselves to be jury, judge, and executioner. And we would be lying to ourselves if there were not times in our lives when we wanted to do the same. Maybe not slaying someone, but certainly taking revenge, vindicating ourselves. But we know that the Bible tells us that vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. And Jesus has told us to forgive those who have wronged us. And each of us could probably make a long list of the people who have wronged us. And if we're looking at those situations through the flesh, we could probably list many ways that we would like to issue vengeance upon them. But it is not for us to do so, friends. We have all heard of stories of someone who is violently killed or raped or beaten or mistreated. And when we hear the family member talk, they talk about they're going to forgive them. They're not going to hold it in their heart against them. And if we put ourselves in their shoes, we may find this very difficult to understand. Because in that moment when it becomes very personal and we feel like we've been violated, the emotions that run deep within us, specifically anger, cause us to want to execute judgment upon the person. And that's one of the dangers about a lot of the movies that we watch, because they feed that appetite of executing judgment upon others. And when you watch these movies, you know what I'm talking about, because you're so caught up in the movie that you're saying to yourself, well, if that had been me, I would have killed them. And we find ourselves saying things like that when we watch these movies because we're being drawn into that fantasy world. And even though we wouldn't literally act upon doing such a thing, because we are speaking in that fantasy of that movie, we're saying if we would have been that character, we would have done that. But that's feeding the appetite that even in that moment may not be evident somewhere in the future when it does become a reality for us. There's a very good possibility we could act upon it. We could act in that way. And I think what we learn from this story today is not for us to take into our hands what God has said belongs to him. And even though we may find some humor in this story and how the sons did this and the deception that they used, the fact of the matter is a lot of innocent people died. People that had nothing to do with Shechem's actions. And even after the men of the city were killed, the wives were taken as slaves, and most likely the children were taken as slaves. And so a lot of family units were disoriented because of the selfish actions of two single men. And so let us be very careful how we react in situations that want to cause us to be angry or vengeful. And let us in those moments fall on our face before God and seek His grace and peace in those moments so that we can act with forgiveness and with compassion. Well, we're going to close there today, friends. And again, I'm so grateful that you're with us this morning. I pray that these servants are causing you to want to be a better servant of the living God, and that you learn both from the good and the bad. In other words, you learn what to do and what not to do in any given situation. Well, may your journey be blessed today. May your heart be full of praise. And may you walk in the simplicity of the Lord Jesus. Now, as He wills, and until next time, friends, I truly love you. I'll see you on the next video.